Welcome, everyone. This presentation is going to be a little bit different than I think you're used to seeing here at Cassandra Summit. We're going to talk about graph data from the perspective of a UX designer. So we're going to talk about the process from a design perspective that happens after you stand up a graph database and you start to look at crafting a solution around a rich and complex data set. So I'll walk through the process that we use both for general visualization, graph-based visualization, and just standard practice in UX, best practices for crafting the best user experience. Great, so a little bit about me first. My name is Chris Lacava. I'm a senior UX designer at a company called Expero. I've also worked as a product manager, front-end developer. I've been part of founding a couple startups, so I have a very varied background. And I know what you're thinking, and it's true, my resume is a little bit of a mess. So as I mentioned, I work for a company called Expero. This is a software consultancy around bringing challenging product ideas to life. It's multidisciplinary in nature. More and more, we're being involved with big data problems, and that more and more often also means graph. A lot of our development architecture team is very active in the graph community. You may know a colleague of mine, Ted Wilmes. He's an active contributor to the Tinker project. So we're here to talk about the front end side of things today. So just a quick show of hands, how many people are familiar with graph data? Good. How many people are actively working on a graph data project? Also good. How many people here are UX designers? Awesome. So I want to talk about that because in a sense, everyone's a UX designer. And I want to dig into that a little bit because UX has always been a discipline and now it's transitioning to a philosophy. And that really is the case in graph because there's a ton of innovation and a ton of disruption, but it's coming from the back-end systems. And the front-end is just trying to scurry around, trying to figure out what the opportunities are. So in a sense, the user experience is being driven more and more by the data set and new opportunities that data set presents to us in graph. And it's often the first line of defense for good user experience. Does anyone know what the number one UX complaint is? It's performance. I don't get my data fast enough. I can't send my data back fast enough. There's too much data, there's too little data. It all revolves around data acquisition on the front end and sending that data back to some kind of server entity. So, you all are the first line of defense and a good UX as back-end engineers. So I'm going to briefly just talk through some very high-level graph concepts just to get us all on the same page, and then I'm going to jump into the UX aspects of the talk. Okay, so this is going to be Fisher-Price for a lot of you all, but it'll do me a little good to go over it for my own benefit. So at its simplest, we're looking at a bunch of nodes connected by some kind of relationship. Real simple stuff, intuitive, very easy to conceptualize. Those relationships can be geographically based. They can be familial in nature. They can be some kind of business-oriented relationship. They can be almost anything. They can be multifaceted. And here's the point. The real thing I want to drill in on, they can be complicated, and they get complicated quick. And this is where traditional technologies start to stumble when you take this concept and you apply it to it. And that's there's a correlation also on the front end. All the front end technologies and a lot of the UX best practices that we use, tried and true, traditional, don't necessarily apply directly when we're looking at a graph-based data set. And therein lies the opportunity and the challenge. And that's really what I want to highlight here, is that some UX practices translate beautifully, some of them do not. And that's where I think where the opportunity to be better user-centric really comes into play. So graphs are everywhere. They occur as a pattern in everyday life, transportation, computer networks. They're all over the place. It's a concept that even if people don't understand graph data, they understand. A key thing to note is it's often the natural order of human interaction. So anytime we have a system that's modeling human interaction, it's obviously best served as a graph in a lot of cases on the back end as well. Not always the case on the front end, and we'll get into that. Just because you have a complex data source does not necessarily mean that you should expose that to your front end users. Okay, so we're going to talk a little bit about tailoring a user experience to a specific audience. And most of this is UX 101. It's tried and true methods. We have to spin it a little bit for graph. And I'll call out where we make those distinctions because they're important, and it's often where graph projects stumble. So the first thing, this stuff is gonna sound super intuitive, but the first thing is you gotta know the problem that you're trying to solve. It sounds real simple, but people get this wrong, and it's step zero in this process. They don't write it down, they don't get stakeholders bought into it. Oftentimes, the problem space means a lot of different things to a lot of different people, and it has downstream effects on everything else that comes next. So once you know that, you want to zero in on the user goals within that problem space. And again, a lot of people think that that happens, and maybe it happens early on in the design process or in the architectural design process, but it doesn't always carry through. And then the third rule is know your data, experience it, traverse it, pull it apart, understand the scale of it. This is unique to big data and most appropriately graph because of those complicated relationships. In traditional relational systems, there can be a handshake in the beginning of the design process, and a designer will say, okay, I understand relational databases. It's a finite number of relationships. We can design to this. We can design by contract, and parallel paths ensue. With graph specifically, it's different because you have to understand the data as a designer, not just as an architect. I've seen a lot of designs that are the beautiful wrong thing to design because they just don't understand the data. They look great until you throw all of those relationships in there, or it falls down because of scalability, or it doesn't even map back to the model that's in the back end. So as a designer, this was the hardest thing. It's counterintuitive to stand up and look at data and actually maybe even write a little code to see it before you start designing. So that is where traditional UX breaks with some of this disruptive technology. Okay, so state the problem. It seems simple, but a lot of times it means different things to different people. And it's really just getting down to the root cause, getting everyone bought into it, and making sure that it's concise enough to cover what you want to do. It's basically a lot of times finding the gap between traditional technology and disruptive technology. All of those opportunities that new technologies open up for us often create gaps in their opportunities to solve problems. The next is outlining your user goals. You have to know your users, obviously, and you have to know what they want to do within that problem space. Here, I want to make a distinction between this and the problem set because these should be very specific. They should be measurable because ultimately that's going to define success, and it's going to give you an indicator as you go through the design and development process if you're on the right track. If you're measuring towards these goals, hopefully even quantitatively, then the outcome is going to be a lot better. This is a step that's skipped a lot, or it's kind of just unofficially done through some other design development vetting. This guy on the right, I'm not going to talk about him now, but we're going to come back to him. He's going to become very important later on in the talk. Okay, so We've defined our problem set. We've defined what our users want to do in that problem set. Now we're going to get our hands dirty in the data. And like I said, this really means getting in there and understanding it, not just as an architect, not just as a business person, but as a designer. And what that really means is we take those user goals and we look at the data set and we map what they want to do dimensionally within that data set. We look at what's called the dominant dimensions for that user in the data. And these dominant dimensions are going to be very important later on when we're in the design phase, because it's going to basically be the signpost to the information architecture for that particular user goal or set of users. And it's going to be what we measure completion of task against. That's kind of the holy grail of usability, is successful completion of task. Super sexy term. You guys probably want to use it, but it's trademarked by the UX mafia, so we've got it. So we've got our problem. We've got our user goals defined. We've picked apart our data. We know how we're going to traverse this thing. Now what do? We've got to present it to our users. We've got to design that experience. I'm going to zero in on visualization here. Not that it necessarily has to be presented in visualization, but this is where a lot of things tend to go south as well, is when we've got all of our information and we decide we're going to build this user experience using visual means. A lot of times there are missteps there as designers. So as with anything in this process, we're going to pull the thread through of what the user perspective is. Again, making this user-centric. And that means all the way from what data we're looking at all the way up to how we're presenting it. And of course, we're going to leverage those dominant dimensions that we identified. OK, so to figure out how we're going to show data, the first thing we're going to do is basically ask two simple questions. By the way, this is from a book called Good Charts. It's a really easy read, but it's very powerful if you're looking at different types of visualizations within a software solution, or anything for that matter. So we're going to ask these two questions. They're going to be, is the data that I'm trying to show conceptual, qualitative, or is it data-driven, quantitative? Is it declarative, meaning am I trying to prove a known quantity, put metrics around something that I already know is there, or am I looking for trends? Am I trying to explore data, know what I don't know? And the answers can be mixed here. It can be yes, 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 yes. That just means that the solution that you ultimately come up with from a front-end perspective is going to be hybrid in nature. It's going to be more complicated, and you just have to account for all those different types of visualizations. So we've got the answers to those questions. Now we plot it on these quadrants. And this starts to tell us, it gives us a hint at least at what the visualizations may look like. So we've got conceptual style visuals. We've got quantitative type visuals. We've got visuals that are trying to prove or measure something. We've got visuals that are exploring things we don't know. And quadrant four especially, I want to pay attention to, because this is the most complicated of all of them. This is the stuff of data scientists, and this is where things often go wrong, because you've got a graph database. It's complicated. It's probably huge in a lot of cases. The knee-jerk reaction is to go straight down to data science, and as we'll see later, that may not be the best user experience. Complex data does not necessarily mean complex ways of visualizing and traversing. It's cool, and we all like to do awesome things there as UI designers, but it's often not the right choice, or not the right choice in isolation. It needs to be in conjunction with other things. Okay, so just a little bit more about these quadrants. Idea illustration, you can think of these as flow diagrams or hierarchies or org charts. They're not necessarily quantitative, but they're taking complex relationships and they're boiling down that information so someone can look at it visually at a glance. again, on the conceptual side, but down below in exploration, idea generation is using visual means to validate or collaborate. So a lot of times as designers, this is wireframes to us. It could be whiteboards or other means of ideation. So it's not often considered a visualization type, but it is. And it's very useful, both refined and unrefined. Standard visualization, these are known quantities that we want to measure. You can think of this as tried and true pie charts, bar charts, line charts, things like that. Data exploration, this is the cool stuff where we're traversing geospatial information over three-dimensional space and doing all kinds of great things to deeply analyze large amounts of data. So here's an example of idea illustration. Very complicated thing. It's not necessarily quantitative, but we're getting that across in a very boiled down way. Someone can look at this with some context and understand what's going on here. Idea generation, again, these are wireframes. These are things that designers often use to validate an interface, quick and dirty with a usability test. You can even test these things as well as just get stakeholders on the same page. Standard visualizations, there is a way to get to the best chart that you want to see for the data that you have. Again, tried and true method, very standard, knowable. You can go wrong here, but this is pretty established, and there are tools that will walk you through this. As I mentioned before, exploring the data, not so simple, especially graph. So there are hints here. When we're talking about graph anyway, there are algorithms that lend themselves nicely to graph that may or may not hint to how we should present this information. So this is not an exhaustive list of those algorithms, but they're some of the main ones that we at Expero often bump against. So this stuff, again, does not necessarily equate how you would show exactly this graph data, but it gives you a hint of, if you're dealing, for example, with a centrality algorithm, there are certain ways that you could display that on the front end that will tie into those dominant dimensions that we identified earlier and really measure up against the user goals that we've identified. So back to this guy. He's an interesting guy because he, in this case anyway, is a network administrator and technician for fiber optic network. And he's configuring and troubleshooting basically a large set of fiber optic lines. It's graph data. I mean, he's very interested in graph. He's all about these nodes and these edges and all that stuff. I'll tell you what he's not interested in. He's not interested in a highly interactive node chart of 500,000 nodes that he has to basically go through on a 7-inch by 7-inch screen on that little touch screen device that he has. So the user perspective matters, where they do their work, how they do their work. This is an example of the rich data not equating with what he actually wants to see. I imagine if you forced him to do that, he'd probably take that device and chuck it at the UX designer if you could get a hold of him. So I've talked through the high level of this process. Let me try to talk about it in a little bit more concrete terms with a scenario. And this is a process that we go through at Expero. I personally have gone through this a number of times. I'm going to use a hypothetical situation, pretty simple example, but I think we can tie back what we talked about in some concrete terms. So here's an example of a problem set. It's very concise, a little bit general, but it anchors everything. And in this case, we've got product announcements that happen regionally, and they are then picked up by social media and disseminated in certain ways. And we just don't have enough insight to figure out how that really affects the bottom line, as you know, fictitious product managers will say. So we've outlined a few user goals. One of them is just to be able to see the saturation by region through social media. How did these messages get picked up and permeate? How do we correlate them with financial data? Can we see a correlation? And then just from a high level, can we see the quote unquote health of each of these product announcements in traditional media terms, and then how they permeate through all the other facets that we talked about. So step one, after step zero, I guess step three here, is stand up the data. Look at it, traverse it as a designer in conjunction with your team, and really understand it. In this case, we've got social media data. Let's just say it's in a graph database. We've got something that's probably relational data around market indicators and sales figures and things like that. And then we know what the regional announcements are. So that's metadata around those announcements and you know, date and time. So then we pick it apart and find our dominant dimensions. In this case, we're looking at product announcements. We're going to cut that by time, and we're going to cut it by region. Another thing that we introduce here is something called primary entities. And this is very important because these are the things based on the user goals that we know they want to drill into. They want to see it at a high level, but they want to drill into it. From a user perspective, it makes basically their brain scalable. They can say, okay, I see the big picture. You're telling me there's interesting information here. Let me drill into it and progressively disclose it. That's the term that we use to drill into information. On the back end, these are the opportunities to create a scalable system. If any of you have ever taken a node chart and tried to render it on a web page, it's hard. A lot of times there are scalability issues. You have to take this, tactic of progressive disclosure as an opportunity to be able to chunk up the data and switch the user to potentially subgraphs and things like that. And those primary entities are going to give you the opportunity to do that along these dominant dimensions without disrupting the flow. It's a natural progression, especially when exploring data. So we look at the data, we figure out that, yes, in fact, financial indicators are inconsistent across regions, and that we see a strong correlation between sales and social media activity within a region. Now what? Then we start to design the front end. Not until this point. And that's an important part and a little bit of a break between traditional UX design. So here's a quick example of a design. Here are the dominant dimensions. We've got an indicator across the top. The first way we're going to slice this data is look at it through the lens of campaigns, or you can think of these as product announcements. We've got our regional information mapping out the social media activity. And here's our exploration, our graph, our node chart over geospatial. And then we're slicing that all by time. So we hit all those dominant dimensions, and this really mirrors the flow of a lot of the goals that we set out. And here are our primary entities. These are the things that are going to light up on this dashboard that tell the user that there's something interesting there and they've got to drill into. So you see here that they've drilled into one of these news stories within one of these campaigns. And then if we want to drill into a node, we can see that now we're into the centrality algorithm. We can show that we've got a person of interest that we've drilled in at a point in time within a certain region that's influential. And we decorate that information not just with a node chart, but with a stack rank grid of that information. And that's important because the grid tells them intuitively how they're related. The chart tells them something that their brain can scan very quickly. And we decorate all of this with some of those standard visualizations. As you see up top, there's financial KPIs and other indicators that give this all context. How the user got to this data, in the case of exploration anyway, is as important as the data itself because it tells them the pattern. Here's another example of centrality algorithm. This is the tried and true customer 360 view, but it's the same idea. We always contextualize the node chart, in this case the node chart, with standard visualization and other very grokkable information. Now, if this was our friend in the field with the 7x7 screen, he may only get the list of information here, and that may be enough because he may just want to know what that stack rank list is, what house does he have to hook up next in his fiber optic to-do list. And then drilling down into this again, an example of progressive disclosure, we are showing how we can decorate this with information, both relational and non-relational, but still keep that context of the node. Again, giving the user those signposts that they've indicated are part of their goals. Okay, so that is an example of the process. So let's say, for the sake of argument, that we've nailed the design. Now, how do we implement it? And there's a million different ways, and a lot of them are viable. I'm going to talk a little bit about the tools that we use at Expero and some of the ones that I've used specifically. And this is not meant to be exhaustive by any stretch of the imagination. Most of the stuff I'm talking about here is web-delivered. It's just what my background is. And I've culled the list back down to things that I'm most familiar with. Like I said, there's a giant ocean of this stuff out there, and it's only getting bigger every day. So things to note, though, is whatever tool you use, it should be driven by the spec. So you should have a spec before you start picking tools, but more importantly, it should tie back to that spec. And at least with this stuff, the tools are probably going to be a combination between licensed software, open source, and custom-built stuff. And that is both a blessing and a curse, because if you don't do that correctly, you're going to create a Frankenstein application that's hard to use and really hard to maintain. So anything that you do should be cohesive, and there are certain things that you can do up front to ensure some of that cohesion. So our first step of standing up the data and experiencing it, there are a ton of tools out there. But you may have the tools that you need right in DataStax Studio. Great tool. You can see the schema. You can see the nodes. You can traverse them. You can drill into them. It's got the progressive disclosure. You may have all you need there for experiencing the data and then beyond. There are other things out there, like here I have Link Curious Enterprise. It's a similar type of experience, but it's something, basically it's a software package that backs up to your backend application, and you can again traverse the nodes and things like that. It also has other features. It's got geospatial capabilities. It also has the ability for you to basically administrate users and share information amongst users and save certain visualizations. So it's a pretty robust reporting tool on top of some of the other visualization. And this may be all you need. You may be done with your UX experience at this point. For your user goals, this may fit the bill. But if it's not, you're probably into the realm of starting to build some custom software. So holding it all together. At Expero, we like to pick modern UI frameworks to do this. There's a lot of benefit to that. We generally, all things being equal, will use React with Material UI in conjunction. There's a lot of other combinations that you could use here, but the point is that you're going to get a lot of things out of this with relatively little effort. It's going to keep your designers and your developers on the rails, meaning that there is a methodology assigned to this UI framework, and there's no riffing on it, at least not easily. And all of those interactions that you're creating that surround these visualizations especially are going to be uniform. They're going to be cohesive. So this is a tactic to ensure cohesion around an application built by a lot of different libraries. You're also going to get stuff like responsiveness and browser compatibility for relatively cheaply, if not free, depending on your browser matrix. So there are millions of things here that you could use, but these are what we often go back to in this case. So looking at node visualizations, the node chart, ton of options here. I've narrowed this down to five that we often come back to, but there are a ton of options. Link Curious JS is basically the JS library version or the set of widgets that are used in Enterprise as a packaged piece of software. This is basically just the library that you can pick and choose and use those widgets with. Keylines is another licensed piece of software that contains widgets in a library. Both are very good. We've used them for projects in the past. And then there's a bunch of open source stuff, D3, everyone's using. SigmaJS is pretty good. It is under the covers basically the library that Linkurious has extended. So if you want a bare bones version of a node chart that mirrors Linkurious, that's Sigma. There's a ton other here. So many I can't keep up with them, but there are a lot of options. So geospatial, again, a ton of options. Linkurious and key lines have direct interaction with a node chart in the map itself. So if you want to seamlessly pivot between a geospatial presentation and a node chart visualization, these might be the trick. So there's tight integration there between those two widget types. If you're just interested in the map side of it and you're going to build on top of that, there are a ton of map APIs that you can use. Leaflet.js is a JS library that Linkurious and Keylines use. So it's the same functionality, it's just they build their tools on top of it. Mapbox is a paid service, but it has some very cool maps and some really easy ways to interact and write software on top of it. So visualizations for standard charts, again, like too many for me to ever figure out, but I often come back to Chart.js just because they're clean looking, easy to implement. They're really nice charts, and for simple representation, they may be the trick. Again, there's tons of stuff here. And I want to call out a specific widget in the Keylines library because I think it warrants it. If you're working with time series data, Keylines has a time bar widget, and it's very robust, interaction-wise anyway. From a UX perspective, you can zoom in and out of that timeline. You can superimpose histogram information on top of that timeline. You can set a time window that the user can reset and move across. So it basically takes that window across that series and keeps it locked in. It has playing capability through a time series, or the user can paginate through it very easily. You can use it in conjunction with the node chart as well. So again, there's tight integration there. If you're looking at time series information and that's a dominant dimension, this may be the widget. You could repurpose or rebuild a lot of stuff, but I don't think it would easily be done to the extent of a lot of the interactivity that is provided in Keylines. So just to sum up, this is the implementation side of the UX design experience. This would be where, in conjunction, UX designers and developers collaborate to bring this stuff to life. And you know, this fits into our process that we talked about earlier about standing up the data, looking at it, and all the way through design and implementation, obviously. So that's all I got. Thanks so much for your time, and good luck with your graph projects. And I'm more than happy to answer questions. I think we're just about at time here, but I'll stay a little later. And feel free to hit me up directly on Twitter or email or whatever. More than happy to keep the conversation going. Thank you.